Okay, in this lesson we're going to go ahead and add things to the carbonyl to reduce the carbonyl, either in aldehydes or ketones. And in this case, we'll either form we'll form alcohols actually. But the other important thing too is that the things that we'll be adding will either be a hydride, which is a hydrogen with a negative charge, or we'll be adding a carbanion, which is a carbon with a negative charge like that. So given that information, let's go ahead and start the lesson. Okay, so what we're asked to do is to go ahead and form the major product, okay, of tertiary butyl chloride, magnesium, and formaldehyde. And then we go ahead and do something called a hydronium workup like that. So let me show you what you need to do first for this reaction. So we'll go ahead and make tertiary butyl chloride. Okay, so we'll come in here and we'll put our chlorine right here. Okay, the next step of the reaction is it tells us to go ahead and react this with magnesium. So let's go on the periodic table and choose magnesium from here. Then we'll go ahead and add. Okay, and now the only thing wrong with this whole picture right here is that magnesium doesn't really have two hydrogens to it right here. Okay, which is completing the valency, or the program just does that by default. Okay, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to go ahead and delete the two hydrogens on here right here. Okay, but what we have with the magnesium, and that's why we throw the magnesium in there, is that we do have two electrons, because magnesium is willing to become positively two charged. Okay, so what this magnesium does with this tertiary butyl chloride is that actually it goes ahead and puts an extra electron between the carbon and the chlorine right here. Okay, and where does it put it? It puts it in a sigma antibonding orbital, and that's why it was important to learn about antibonding orbitals. When you put electrons into antibonding orbitals, then what happens is that the bonds break like that. Okay, and so what's going to happen is that we're basically going to break this bond apart, okay, so that we form a carbon radical, and the extra electron that we would have here on the chlorine right here, okay, so let me go ahead and add an extra electron here. Okay, goes ahead and pairs up with the chlorine on that part right there. Let me go ahead and hit arrange. Okay, and let me go ahead and fit everything on here so you can see it a little larger. Let me resize. Okay, now I added an extra electron here. Where did that electron come from? It came from the magnesium. Okay, now in this case it's unpaired, so I'll go ahead and pair the electrons up. Okay, so by adding one electron from the magnesium, okay, to the carbon chlorine bond, okay, I've made a carbon radical and I've made a chloride. Okay, the intermediate was something called a radical anion, which was an electron that was put into a sigma antibonding orbital. Okay, I'm sorry, some of these things can't be illustrated that well like this. Okay, now the next thing that magnesium does for this species is that it goes ahead and gives us an extra electron. Okay, why? Because the magnesium had two electrons to give. Okay, so we'll add an extra electron over here. Okay, the program complains about octet exceeded because I have too many bonds right now. Okay, and the reason why it's complaining right now is because these electrons, the way I have them drawn, they're unpaired like that. So I'll use chemistry to go ahead and pair these things again right here. Okay, so when I pair them, now I can go ahead and take a look at this species right here, and hopefully I will be able to see that I have, well, let me hit arrange here, okay? Okay, that I have a non-bonding pair of electron on the carbon. Okay, now this species right here, because the carbon now has a negative charge, okay? So let me go ahead and show the negative charge on the carbon. Okay? So negative charge on carbon, negative charge on chlorine. Okay, where did this extra charge come from? It came from the magnesium that we have in the structure right here. It came from there. Okay? Now that we've done this, let me show you an easier way of actually getting to the species right here. Because essentially, if you consider that magnesium is electropositive and the chlorine and the carbon are more electronegative than the magnesium right here, then what you can actually do to get to this picture much faster is just consider that all that we did was really insert the magnesium between the carbon-chlorine bond of the thing we call alkyl halide, the thing that has the chlorine and carbon on it like that. And so that's all we did. We just inserted on here. And the whole purpose was to make a carbanion. Okay, now that we have a carbanion, Okay, now we need to react with formaldehyde. So we remember formaldehyde is the simplest of the aldehydes, okay, or carbon-oxygen double bond compound with at least one hydrogen flanking on the carbon. Okay, and then we'll go ahead and come back here and add hydrogens on here. The program had the same problem again. It added extra hydrogens on there. And so we'll come in here and we'll delete those hydrogens because they don't belong on the magnesium. Okay, and then we'll hit arrange. Okay, and so now we go ahead and look for our nucleophile and we look for our electrophile. Okay, and so the magnesium is attracted to the oxygen, okay, but it's mostly a spectator, okay, because it's so electropositive. Okay, so that is attracted to that part right there. The chloride is attracted to the carbon, that is true. This is could be a nucleophile right there. But more importantly, this carbon is a much stronger nucleophile because chlorine is more electronegative than carbon. So the carbon is more willing to give up its electrons to that carbonyl right there. So that's what we'll do. We'll go ahead and use the electrons from the carbanion, the carbon anion species right here, to go ahead and add to the carbonyl, release electrons up here, okay, and then we'll hit arrange, okay, and then we'll fit the structure. Okay, we'll move things around, okay, and the counterion to this O minus and to this chloride, okay, for both of these species is magnesium. Okay, so we have this bonding now, and actually the bonding between oxygen and magnesium is much better now like this. Okay, now the last thing we want to do is go ahead and do a hydronium workup for this reaction. And why do we have to do a hydronium workup? It's because, okay, you know, that's usually how we introduce acid. We have to introduce acid with some water in there. But I won't draw OH3 plus for the hydronium. All I really need to do is protonate that species right there. Okay, so I'll come in here and I'll go ahead and add a hydrogen, and then I'll go ahead and use the electrons from the oxygen to make a bond to the hydrogen. Okay, now I don't really need all these other species over here, okay, because it's not asking for the byproducts or anything. It's just asking for the major organic product. So I can go ahead and eliminate my magnesium and my chlorine right here. Okay. So what this whole recipe is really for, okay, in other words, alkyl halide, in other words, a carbon with a halogen attached to it, plus a metal, is to form a carbanion. Once you have the carbanion, all you're doing is doing an addition to a carbon-oxygen double bond to a carbonyl, where the carbon electron-rich carbon is attracted to the electron-deficient carbon. Once you make O minus, then you do the hydronium workup and you're able to go ahead and make, okay, an alcohol out of this. So basically formaldehyde, when it reacts with these compounds, okay, in this particular compound, the one that you react with tertiary butyl chloride and magnesium, is called a Grignard reaction or a Grignard reagent, okay? And that when you make that particular compound, right, they add to what? To carbonyls right there. And why is this a reduction? Well, because the particular carbon, before it was bonded to two oxygen twice right there, had an oxidation state of zero. And if you look at it now, and you calculate the oxidation state, now it's at minus one. So by bonding to carbon, we've actually reduced this carbon over here. What actually got oxidized at the final analysis is this magnesium, because it went from magnesium zero to magnesium two plus. Okay, let's look at another of these questions, okay? Okay, in this question, we're going to go ahead and react chloroethane with lithium, okay? Now, chloroethane or alkyl halides with lithium are a little simpler to understand than, let's look for chlorine here, than the reaction of chloroethane with, for instance, magnesium right here, okay? And the idea is that basically what you're going to do is you're going to replace that chlorine with a lithium. Okay? This is actually the net reaction. How it works actually is that lithium first gives an electron to the carbon-chlorine bond, and that causes the carbon-chlorine bond to break, just like we saw in the previous problem. And that'll make a radical, and then you'll need another equivalent of lithium to go ahead and make the carbon an anion. Okay? But just to save a step, okay, when you're working with lithium, it should look like just a substitution. And then you'll remember that lithium is much more electronegative than carbon, And so because of that, we can go ahead and use chemistry and actually show the product of the reaction of chloroethane and lithium. Okay, this would be ethyl lithium right there. That's okay, and it's a carbanion species right here. Next thing we'll do is we'll go ahead and draw propanone onto the screen so we can see what's going to happen. So here we have propanone, okay, the simplest ketone that we could have. Okay, and when we have this ketone, we can go ahead and get things oriented, right? Okay, now the program added an extra bond to, or an extra hydrogen to lithium right there, so we can go ahead and delete that part right there. Okay, now that we have this species right here, we have the electron-deficient carbon and we have the electron-rich carbon right there. And so we'll go ahead and use chemistry to bond this carbon to this carbon, so we're doing a net addition reaction. Okay, initially it'll be the counterion for the O minus, or the oxide, will be the lithium right here. Okay, but just take a look at what we're going to do at the end. We're going to do a hydronium workup, which is just another way of saying that we're going to introduce acid. So I'll introduce my proton, okay, and once I've got my proton right here, then I can go ahead and use the base, the O minus, to go ahead and pick up that hydrogen right there. So let me go ahead and move the electrons from here to here, and let me go ahead and hit arrange. And we don't need the lithium in there anymore, because on the workup we'll wash it out with any water. Okay, we'll be putting all this stuff in a separatory funnel and doing some washing. Okay, so I hope now you can identify the pieces of the original reaction, okay, or the original reactants. You see, this is an ethyl group from the chloroethane part. Okay, the propanone is this part right here. Okay, here was the carbon-oxygen double bond. And so the net reaction was to add carbon to the carbonyl carbon. Just like before, this carbon was reduced compared to the propanone that we had first. Okay, the original propanone was at the plus 2 stage, and if we took a look at this carbon now, okay, this carbon is now at the plus 1 stage right there. Okay, the other thing I want you to notice is that a ketone adds one of these alkyl lithium reagents. In other words, adds this species that had a carbanion here, okay, to make a tertiary alcohol. This is called a tertiary alcohol because where the alcohol or the hydroxyl group is attached, okay, that carbon is actually tertiary. Okay, it's important because most aldehydes, except for formaldehyde, when you add or do this kind of reaction like is in this lesson right here, they tend to make secondary alcohols. Okay, so ketones make what? Tertiary alcohols. So just by a net addition reaction. Okay, the next question, okay. Now we're going to take propanol and react it with methyl magnesium chloride. Okay, and so let's draw propanol first. Okay, actually propanol has 3 carbons in it. So let me add another carbon right here. And let's draw methyl magnesium chloride. Okay, so let's simplify this by drawing methyl magnesium chloride in this way. Okay, this compound is by insertion in magnesium to make a Grignard reagent, okay? Or Grignard reagent, okay? Then we'll go ahead and add our electrons. Okay, and then now all we have to remember is that magnesium is more electron positive than carbon or this chlorine right here. And so what we should do is actually take the electron away from the carbon, I mean away from magnesium. Okay, and so when we do that, now we realize the real nature of this reagent. Okay, the Grignard reagent is actually more like a salt, okay? And because it is more like a salt, then this is a carbanion right here species, which is a nucleophilic carbon that's attracted to an electrophilic carbon. So we'll go ahead and use chemistry to go ahead and move the electrons and make a bond between carbon-carbon, release electrons up here, okay, and hit arrange. Okay, and then we'll fit the structure on here. Okay, now, just like I said previously, right, this was an aldehyde originally, and we said that these reagents, right, alkyl lithium or alkyl magnesium species, the Grignard reagents, right, they add carbon to make secondary alcohols. So beautifully, this is what we've actually formed this particular reaction right here. Okay? Now, I'm suspicious about this one right, about this lesson right here. Okay, because we'll do the hydronium workup right here, okay? And so I'll go ahead and bring a proton in here. Okay? And why am I suspicious about this reaction right here? Well, in this particular reaction, okay, so let me show you this, okay? You notice how we made a chiral center right here, okay? And that was because we added the carbon to one face of the carbonyl. If you actually take the same carbonyl and were to add the carbon on the other side, you would also make another alcohol, which is the enantiomer of this compound right here. And so I'm suspicious that that's what this reaction is looking for, because it says organic products. And so the truth is that this reaction doesn't just make this compound, it also makes the mirror image of this compound right here. Now because of that, okay, and being suspicious and everything like this, what I'm going to do is I'm going to also make the mirror image of this compound. So let me go ahead and draw the mirror image of this compound. Okay, it'll have four carbons just like this compound. Okay, and I'll introduce the oxygen up here. Okay, and I'll hit arrange. Okay, so look very carefully at the syntax of the question, how it is right there, okay? And this is just to make you realize, you know, that this is a secret of organic chemistry, okay? When organic chemists do reactions on and start with materials like petroleum or anything else from the ground like this, without the aid of biology in some sense like this, then organic chemists always make mixtures of enantiomers. And these mixtures that you're forming right here, okay, in other words, if you make a chiral compound, you're always going to make a mixture of the compound and its mirror image. The reason why this happens is because there's no preference, right? In other words, all the stuff from the ground started off symmetric, and so you have to end up with a symmetric product. You have to conserve symmetry. So if you're making a chiral compound to conserve symmetry, you're also going to make its mirror image. Okay, and because of that then the name of these two compounds right here is called a racemic mixture. Okay, and so I think this is what the program is going to be looking for. Okay, and that's what it is. Okay, so this was really quite a complicated problem like this. Just keep in mind, if this lesson is asking you to make a chiral compound and it's telling you that it wants the products, then it's probably looking for the racemic mixture, the mixture of enantiomers. Just to make sure that you realize that you can, when you run these reactions, organic chemists always make racemic mixtures or mixtures of enantiomers. Okay, now we get to a different type of question. Okay, in this question, we're going to react pentanal and aldehyde, okay, by reduction again. Okay, so we'll start off with five carbons. We'll put the carbonyl in here at the end because that's an aldehyde. And then we'll go ahead and form this compound, okay, sodium borohydride. Okay, and just show you the character of this compound. So we'll ask the program to help us make this compound, and I'll even put in a sodium in here right there. And I'll ask it to add stuff to here. And then we'll notice there's something wrong right here, okay. So the structure of the sodium borohydride is actually where, realizing that hydrogen is more electronegative than sodium, we're going to take its electrons and we're actually going to bond to this. So this, okay, this tetrahedral compound over here, okay, is sodium borohydride, okay? Well, this is the counterion. We know that one is plus, okay? Sodium has a plus charge, and this boron has a negative charge, okay? Because it has four bonds to it right here. Okay, so basically these reagents, okay, which are called hydride reagents, because in this case we can actually release electrons. Now you see the difference in the color of the side of the tube of the electron right here. And that's just telling you that the electrons are actually polarized in one direction or the other. For instance, in this case in the carbonyl, okay, in the carbonyl, we have the electrons polarized towards the carbon right here. And that's because this carbon is electron deficient. In the case of the sodium borohydride, the electrons are polarized towards the hydrogen. Okay? Now with that in mind then, these hydride reagents allow us to go ahead and remove hydrogen with electrons. And when you do that and you go ahead and check the charge, because now I'm showing two electrons on the hydrogen, you have a minus charge. And so this species right here, H minus, is called hydride. Now that hydride reagent can be used to go ahead and function as the nucleophile. Nucleophile to our electrophilic carbon. So we go ahead and bond hydrogen to carbon, and then we go ahead and release electrons up to oxygen. Okay? And now we have the choice of actually bonding either to ionically bonding sodium to the oxygen, or the other choice is actually to take this compound, okay, BH3 is called borane, okay, much like your organic chemistry class, borane, okay, and you can actually go ahead now and you can bond this oxygen to the boron. And you're doing that because you're following the Lewis octet rule, right? In other words, the boron has an empty space, and so it's electron deficient. And so now we make a species that now has a negative charge on the boron. Okay, you can check the charge again right there. Okay, now I show you this part right here because now that you have this boron with a negative charge, if you have another equivalent of an aldehyde or more pentanol, then you can go ahead and use those electrons from the borate, okay, or from this species, right, from boron minus right here, and you can release another hydride to it, okay? And that's why when you see sodium borohydride or its relative lithium aluminum hydride, you have to consider that this reagent can actually give us four hydrogens that can be added to an electron deficient carbonyl right here, okay? Now, with all that said, okay, at the end of the day, what happens now when you go ahead and do the hydronium workup? And the other thing that states here is the methanol. The only purpose of the methyl in this reaction is the solvent. This is the usual solvent they use for sodium borohydride. Okay, well, at the end of the day, what's going to happen, okay, and sort of let me show you that mechanism. When you add the hydronium, okay, eventually you'll have borons, and all these borons will be attached to an oxygen right there. So what will you be able to do with the boron, okay, is you'll go ahead, you'll be able to go ahead and, put an extra proton in here. Let's put hydrogen here, not oxygen, okay? And with the hydronium in there, you'll be able to go ahead or with a proton in there, you'll be able to go ahead and protonate the oxygen. And now the oxygen will want its electrons back. And eventually, all the valencies of boron will be filled with oxygen. And so therefore, boron will actually come to make a compound called boric acid, which is basically boron bonded to hydroxyl groups right here. Okay, so at the end of the day, okay, when we go ahead and arrange everything, okay, what did we do in this reaction? Okay, well, let me go ahead and erase everything else that we have on here, because all of that stuff will be washed out when we do our workup and our extractions. Okay, so at the end of the day, what you see is that initially you had pentanol, a carbon-oxygen double bond on here. You added hydride by adding hydrogen to the electron deficient, or in other words, H minus was added to the electron deficient carbon. Okay, to the oxygen, you added a proton, okay, from the hydronium, okay, or from the acid workup like that. Okay, and so that's why aldehydes, when they get reduced, because this is a reduction product, okay, when they get reduced, okay, with hydride, okay, they actually make primary alcohols. And we'll see that ketones, when they add a hydrogen on here, they make a secondary alcohol. So this should be the product of this reaction. Okay, and this one, for this one, we're asked again to go ahead and react 1-chloropropane. Okay, so let's go ahead and make the 1-chloropropane. Okay, but let's take a shortcut here, okay? Remember, the 1-chloropropane or alkyl halides react with magnesium to make a Grignard. So my shortcut will be to go ahead and just put the magnesium in the place of the chlorine, okay? And then we'll put the chlorine over here, okay? And then we'll put our ethanol over here. So we'll put our 2-carbon piece, okay? And then we'll put our aldehyde here at one of the ends right here, hopefully so they're all nice and close. Okay, then we bond everything together, okay, And now we remember that magnesium is electropositive, so a better picture for this would be actually to release the electrons to make a carbanion. Okay, and so this is really C minus M magnesium plus, 2 plus actually. Want to check the charge of this one? Okay, a 2 plus species, and Cl minus right here. Okay, so we have the nucleophilic carbon. So let's go ahead and take our nucleophilic carbon, which will react with our electrophilic carbon from the carbonyl and release electrons from here. Okay, and we'll go ahead and delete all the extra pieces because we don't need those. Okay, and we'll hit arrange. And when we do that, okay, remember the last thing we have to do is we have to add acid to this thing. And the acid is the source for the proton to go ahead and make an alcohol out of this thing. Excuse me. So I'll go ahead and take some electrons and bond them up there, and I'll hit arrange. Okay, and things didn't work out because I really didn't aim at my electrons well. So let me go ahead and bond these electrons again. Okay, and I'll hit arrange. Let me make this a little larger so I can go ahead and take a look at everything. Okay, I'll move this down over here. And let me take some of these electrons, let me say take these, right, and make a bond to the hydrogen up here. Okay, and so what I've just formed, okay, is from an aldehyde, I added, from this aldehyde, right, the aldehyde was this portion, I added the 3-carbon piece using the nucleophilic carbon that was formed from making the Grignard reagent of 1-chloropropane and magnesium. Okay, the next step of the reaction was to go ahead and do the workup, and so I protonated the O- species that I had left over, right, originally coordinated with magnesium, but when you do the workup, you can go ahead and replace the magnesium with hydrogen and make a nice covalent bond in this case right there. Okay, here I'm suspicious again of the name because it's saying organic products. And so I look at this compound and I say, wait a minute here, it's a chiral molecule, and both the ethanol and the 1-chloropropane and the magnesium, everything was symmetric here, so I must form a symmetric product. And so that means that this compound doesn't just make this particular enantiomer or chiral compound, it also makes the enantiomer. So let me go ahead and resize this. Okay, let me go ahead and move this molecule over to the left side. So if I have that molecule, I also have to form its mirror image to conserve symmetry. Okay, and so when I do that, I make a racemic mixture, which is a mixture, a 50-50 mixture of enantiomers. Okay, and so for instance, this particular one is S, and so this one is R. So I've made a racemic mixture, and this is what the program is actually looking for. Okay, question number 6. Now we'll take acetone and we'll react with an alkyl magnesium species or a Grignard reagent. So we'll draw our acetone first. We'll also go ahead and put our carbon for the methyl. Let's put acetone. Okay, and then we'll put in our magnesium. And we'll put in our iodine. We'll add all our hydrogens to all our species, hit arrange. Okay, and then we'll remember that carbon and iodine are more electronegative than magnesium. So we'll go ahead and release electrons up to here and to here. And that'll make us realize that the carbon is the most nucleophilic species in this mixture right here. And so when we do that, we can go ahead and use the carbon as the nucleophile to go ahead and react. Okay, now I'm releasing the wrong electrons right here. Well, let me see what I'm doing over here in the back. Okay, everything is still attached properly. So let's use chemistry again. Take the electrons from here, make a bond. Okay, break a bond. Okay. And so a ketone reacts with a Grignard reagent to make a tertiary alcohol. Okay, so this is going to be tertiary butyl alcohol. Okay, where do we get the hydrogen from here? It's from the hydronium, from the acid workup. Okay, that's hydronium, just a fancy way of saying acid and water. Okay, and so we'll put the proton in here from the acid. Okay, remember there'll be counter ions. Don't put too much acid in there. Okay, and so we take electrons from the oxygen, make a bond to hydrogen, delete all the extra things that we have. Here it's only asking for one organic product, and we can tell it's only one because even if we try to draw the mirror image of this thing, it would turn out to be the same product right here. Okay, because this molecule is not chiral. Okay, so this should be the product of the reaction of acetone and methyl magnesium iodide, or a Grignard reagent. So ketones add Grignard reagents to make what? Tertiary alcohol. Okay, in the next question, we're going to go ahead and react 3-pentanone. With a species that should look very similar to lithium aluminum hydride. This ether is just the solvent for the reaction, so we won't draw it in there. So I'll go ahead and put aluminum on the screen. I'll go ahead and also put lithium up on the screen. And then I'll go ahead and add hydrogens. Okay, remembering that lithium is more electropositive than hydrogen, then I'll actually show the structure of this compound, which is actually an aluminum bonded to hydrogen, to four hydrogens right here. Okay, so here's the hydrogen reagent. Okay, now this reagent is really overkill or too much for this particular reaction, because it's much easier to go ahead and react aldehydes and ketones with sodium borohydride as opposed to lithium aluminum hydride like this. And the reason why it's actually more dangerous to react with this one. This is actually a very reactive compound like this is because aluminum is less electronegative than boron, and because of that, then okay, and also because of hard acid and base concepts like this, then this aluminum is more willing to give up this hydrogen right here. Okay, so we'll use chemistry to go ahead and release these electrons, okay, and we'll reassign them over here to the carbonyl, and we'll go ahead and reduce this carbon right here. So in this case, ketones add hydride reagents to make secondary alcohols. Okay, now once we've done that, what really happens to this oxygen is it bonds to the aluminum again. And just like sodium borohydride, okay, this reagent, okay, the aluminum is ready to release more hydrogen. Okay, and so you don't have to use a full equivalent of lithium aluminum hydride to the ketone. You can actually do the stoichiometry of 4-1, but most people when they run these reactions they go ahead and use an excess of it. Okay, so it's usually pretty wasteful like this, but people just want to make sure that they get as much compound as possible. A lot of times because this these reagents actually when they sit around for a while like this they're not as good as when they're fresh. Okay. We'll do the hydronium workup, so eventually we'll replace this aluminum with hydrogen. So now that I have a hydrogen on here like this, let me just go ahead and bond this. Okay, and let me go ahead and hit arrange. And so, again, okay, I hope you can see the pentan-3-one structure right here. This is where the carbonyl was. And the lithium aluminum hydride, all it did is it added what? Hydride, or hydrogen to the electron-deficient carbon. And the hydronium workup is the source for this proton so that we can go ahead and make a secondary alcohol. Since this compound is achiral, it's not chiral, then that's why the program only asks for one product. No racemic mixture is possible. Okay, here we have butanol, so four carbons. Methyl is going to be at the 3 position. We'll form our carbonyl over here. Okay, and we'll add lithium aluminum hydride. Okay, rather than LAH, we wrote out the name and we'll do a hydronium workup. Now, to make this easier for ourselves like this, we just have to realize that in the aldehyde, okay, without having to do all the steps that we did before just to show you how the mechanism worked like this, that in the aldehyde, okay, lithium aluminum hydride is just going to add a hydrogen here. Okay, so we can manually go in here and we can go ahead and add a hydrogen here. Okay, octet succeeded because you have too many bonds, and I'll add a hydrogen here. Okay, that hydrogen is going to come from the hydronium workup. And all I have to do is realize, well, this is a net addition, So I'll go ahead and remove the double bond from here like that. So keeping that in mind, you can actually operate and do these reactions very quickly, which is basically telling you that 3-methylbutanol reacts with a hydride reagent to make a primary alcohol. Primary because this carbon is only bonded to one carbon. Okay, now we have acetaldehyde, and we can do the simple or the same kind of simplification. Acetaldehyde is a 2-carbon aldehyde. That's a common name for ethanol. Okay, and all we have to consider, okay, is that we're going to add what? With a sodium borohydride, we're going to add hydrogen. We're going to add hydrogen over here because it's going to come on as a hydride reagent. Okay, now keep in mind we already had a hydrogen on here from the aldehyde. So we add a second hydrogen here. We break the pi bond. Okay, and the O minus that gets generated right here gets protonated using hydronium. So we just go ahead and ask the program to add the hydrogen. We have a very simple way of getting to a primary alcohol in this case. So with enough practice, you can actually get to the product without having to draw the whole mechanism. You can see the net reaction of addition or reduction, reductive addition to an aldehyde or a ketone, is just to add two things to get rid of the pi bond. One to the carbon and one to the oxygen. Okay, and so we'll try one more time. Okay, and we'll put the oxygen right here. Okay, and this will be the carbonyl originally, but remember we're just going to add extra hydrogen here from the sodium borohydride and here from the hydronium workup. So we don't even have to put the double bond in there if we realize the pattern of the things that we've been doing. Okay. Same thing goes for the reactions of alkyl magnesium or alkyl lithium reagents. Once you realize the pattern is a net addition and reduction of the carbon, once you realize that aldehydes are reduced with a hydride reagent to a primary alcohol and ketones are reduced to a secondary alcohol with a hydride reagent, or if you have a primary, if you have an aldehyde and you react with an alkyl lithium or alkyl magnesium, you make a secondary alcohol. Or if you have a ketone and you react with an alkyl lithium or alkyl magnesium species, you make a tertiary alcohol, then you can go ahead and run these reactions very quickly without having to draw all the intermediates for the reactions, which is not what this program is asking you at this stage right there. So with that all that information, hopefully you will be able to do this lesson with lots of practice.